Hi, my name is Reginald Brown. I'm a technical account manager with the Fortify On Demand team. I'm going to be giving this presentation on static code analysis, and specifically, we're going to be deep diving into two topics. One of the eight analyzers that runs as part of the static code analysis when you submit a payload, specifically the data flow analyzer. And the other thing that we're going to cover today is false positive challenges and what a false positive is. So a little bit about me to start us off today. Before coming to Microfocus, I was a developer. So what I do with FOD essentially is work with teams to help understand vulnerabilities, both immediately after scans and also false positive challenges, sort of understanding why maybe something is not considered a false positive. I also help integrate tools into your build environment to help you automate the process of submitting payloads to FOD. I have development experience, professional development experience in JavaScript, Python, and C#. In a previous life, way back in high school and college, I did C++ and Java development as well. But it's been a long time for those two tech stacks. So our agenda today, we're going to cover SCA sort of on a very high level, very quickly. And then we're going to dive into specifically the data flow analyzer. And then we're going to kind of run through some common issues and different roadblocks that developers run into in understanding results from the data flow analyzer. And then a quick discussion about false positives. To understand SCA, the code, the Fortify code analyzer, and it runs against a pseudo language that it understands. So there is a translation process. We can actually scan natively .NET and Java payloads. And then, of course, there's no translation process needed on your end for an interpreted language. Something like HTML, there is no compilation, so you wouldn't have to do any sort of translation. But sometimes there are translations that have to be done on your end, specifically compiled languages that aren't .NET or Java. And that's because .NET and Java are very standardized, whereas something like C, C++, Scala are not standardized. So if you've got a Scala payload, you've got to do the build and translation process on your end using a plugin. In the case of C, C++, there's not really a plugin. You use a limited version of the static code analyzer itself to actually do the translation right on your build machine. And again, this is just because those languages aren't quite as standardized as .NET and Java. So it's very build environment dependent. So the easiest way to do it is sort of to generate that MBS file, which is what we would then consume on our end to do a scan. So SCA, once you've translated and submitted your code, is going to run potentially eight analyzers on each scan. It won't necessarily run all eight on every scan. So for example, the configuration analyzer, that one runs specifically on config files. So if you don't submit any config files, it's not going to run. The content analyzer is HTML specific, and that includes dynamic HTML. So something like PHP would be scanned by the content analyzer as well. But the important takeaway there is you don't need to pick which analyzers run. Every analyzer that's necessary for your payload will run automatically. Typically, the one that you have probably run into issues with is the data flow analyzer. So that one takes the longest. It's the source of, I wouldn't say necessarily most vulnerabilities. I mean, I haven't done the analysis to know if it's the source of most, but I can say that it's the source of most vulnerabilities that come back in false positive challenges, most vulnerabilities that we get questions about. And that's due to some issues that we are going to cover today. So the data flow analyzer, anytime you've seen those big long traces on things like any data validation vulnerability where the recommended remediation is validate this data that came from outside the code. So your cross-site scripting, vulnerabilities, open redirect, anything like that is going to be the data flow analyzer. So let's talk about what the data flow analyzer does, and then we'll kind of get into its limitations. So the data flow analyzer detects potential vulnerabilities that involve specifically, and this is straight out of the manual, the data flow analyzer uses global interprocedural taint propagation analysis to detect the flow of data between a source and a sink. What that essentially means is there's two rules, really, with that have come into effect anytime you see something like cross-site scripting. Rule one flagged the source. So there was a site of input, and the manual says site of user input. Understand that SCA doesn't actually know what the input is. There was a site of input from somewhere outside the code. That flags it as tainted. If there is a sink, that means that tainted data is at some point written out. That's going to get flagged. So let's talk about a few gotchas with the data flow analyzer. A few things that are important to understand. Probably the most important thing. The data flow analyzer, and let me take one step back. Data flow analyzer tools in general. Every commercially available data flow analyzer is not path sensitive. Path sensitivity refers to essentially tracking the value of variables. They don't do it. So the example down here, string foo equals null, and then we've got an input which comes from somewhere. If foo does not equal null, call a sink. Pass it this input that we know is tainted. That's getting flagged. It's getting flagged even though we know that string foo does equal null, so it's always going to go to the else and close our program. That sync will never get called. As a human, I can read that and see. String foo does equal null. I didn't do anything with foo. So it's not equal to not null. We're going into the else. But again, the data flow analyzer is not path sensitive. The data flow analyzer does not know what foo equals. So it's going to take that if. And it's going to say branch taken if. And it's going to say you called this sync. And you're going to say, but that branch can't be taken. Again, the data flow analyzer just can't know that. So the reason for that is path-sensitive data flow would add an enormous amount of complexity and potentially make it impossible to finish a scan. So in this example, we've got our string foo equals null. And it's easy to track what foo equals. If it were a bool, it'd be easy to track what it could equal, right? And essentially, we're saying in that if-else that essentially we're using it as a bool. We're saying either it's true or it's not, so we're either calling the sync or we're not. But let's look at input. Input is a string which is equal to something that came from outside our code. If the data flow analyzer were path-sensitive, it would have to track every one of the potential values of input, which would be impossible. There's an infinite number of potential. It's not quite infinite because you're going to be limited on how much memory string takes up. There's an extremely large number of potential variables or potential values for that variable. And therefore, it would dramatically increase the amount of time that it took for this analysis to come back. And again, with enough variables, it would potentially take an infinite amount of time to finish your static analysis. So it's just not realistic. It's not path sensitive. So it will take both of these, and you as a human have to kind of interpret the data and say, okay, in this case, I know I could never have gone into this if I would only take the else branch. Let's look at some examples. This goes back to how the data flow analyzer works and understanding how we can use that to write code that the data flow analyzer can see. Let's look at this example where we've got a source going back to our last example, essentially. But we're going to replace that if foo does not equal null with an if sanitize input. Our sanitization method returns a bool. So I'm saying if it's sanitized, then call my sink. Well, again, it's path insensitive, so we don't know whether or not it's sanitized, right? The SCA is not going to track that, and we're still taking our input and calling that sync where we're writing out somewhere, right? So we're writing out our tainted data, and that's all that the data flow analyzer looks at. Did I get data that's tainted, and did I write it somewhere? The way to get around that is a sanitization method that looks something like this. So I take my input into my function, and I iterate through a whitelist, and I say if my input value equals some value out of my whitelist, then return my whitelist value. So that's important. At this point, we've broken the flow of input in our code. So now I can write out our whitelist value, and I'm not writing tainted data. I'm checking my whitelist against input, and then choosing the correct whitelist value based on the user input or input from outside our code. So that's the only way that SCA would essentially be able to see and detect a whitelist. I wanted to throw in here as well a real life example. The code has been extremely sanitized to protect the guilty. We were using a PHP super global get thing, right? So we were getting something and running through a switch statement. And if get thing wasn't equal to one of, in the real example, it was about 10 different options. If it didn't equal one of those 10 things, then we were defaulting to break. So breaking out of our code. And about 200 lines later, we had print get thing. A developer said, "You say I need to whitelist the value of get thing before I print it out. I did whitelist it. Look at this switch statement 200 lines up. If get thing isn't listed, is an option or option two, then I've broken out of my code." And there's a couple problems with that. So one, data flow analysis, essentially, remember that there's two rules. I look at where it came in and where it went out. And that's all I look at. This came in and was written out on the same line. This super global did not come in 200 lines up at this switch statement. It came in right here. And that's what the auditor sees as well. So when an auditor, if you choose manual audit, and his argument was, I understand that the code analyzer can't see it, but why can't your auditor see it? That would require them reading every line of your code, as opposed to, I look at what SCA, its trace, is it really the vulnerability that I'm describing? If you have to show me that 200 lines earlier, there was a switch statement, and then I have to trust that these 200 lines in the middle included nothing else that would, where I could start my code again, right? I have to essentially trust that this break continues to apply. And so at the end of the day, I just can't accept that as an auditor, right? And this is a perfect example of something that could be written in a way where you don't need to trust the error-prone human audit example, right? It's not always possible to write a whitelist that looks like this, but in this case it is. I've got 10 potential values. I can have a whitelist, right? I can have a validation whitelist with 10 values and iterate through it and return this value. So understanding how SCA works, now that same developer can more easily say, okay, I'll replace my switch statement. I also recommended not to continuously use the same super global. You shouldn't get thing a bunch of times. You should set get thing equal to thing and then only do this super global once, but that's an aside. That's a best coding practice, not a vulnerability issue, but understanding how the code analyzer works and understanding that it's essentially taint flow analysis helps you write your code in a way that the code analyzer understands, and so you don't get the vulnerability in the first place. Let's talk about regex a little bit. So you'll see recommendations on vulnerabilities all the time that recommend something like a character-based whitelist. And for that, you would typically use regex. Now, you could actually write a character-based whitelist that looks like this, right? So you could essentially use a switch statement, iterate through each letter, and have your whitelist be A through Z, lowercase, B for example, A through Z uppercase and numbers, right? That could be my whitelist. And I could essentially use this to build a whitelisted value. It's not as quick and easy as using regex, so I understand if you're not going to do that, but it's possible with a character-based whitelist to create your whitelist and iterate through it a bunch of times and rebuild the input value in a way that you know is only your limited set of characters, and then SCA would detect that. But you're probably actually going to use regular expressions. But understand that SCA cannot detect regex, or it can't evaluate it. It just can't do it. So if you use regex for something like a cross-site scripting vulnerability where we recommend a character-based whitelist, you're probably going to use regex for that. And it's important to understand that the code analyzer won't analyze it. A human might if you choose manual audit. So if you choose manual audit, a human has to do it. There are certain things that are really hard to sort of wrap your head around if you've ever taken over someone else's code, and one of those things is complicated regex. So remember that our auditors are essentially taking over someone else's code every single day of their life. And if you write this really long regular expression that's really hard to understand, firstly, that type of regex will impact your application's performance. But secondly, our auditors would go insane if they had to understand each and every complicated regex that comes through. So if it's something simple, like I'm only allowing A to Z capital, A to Z lowercase, 0 through 9, they're probably going to mark that one as suppressed during the manual audit. If it's something big and complicated, they're probably not. Just understand that we wouldn't be able to get your evaluation back to you, your scan back to you in a reasonable amount of time, if they spent all day going through every single regular expression with a fine-tooth comb, carefully making sure they understand it, and then determining if it is an acceptable remediation for your vulnerability. Knowing that it has to be evaluated by a human, it will often, if it's not very simple, be passed back to you to handle the suppression on your own end. Next up, let's talk about false positive analysis. And I want to talk about this just to help us kind of better understand what is and isn't a false positive, because I think there's a lot of confusion around this. Beginning with the definition, not our definition, but the dictionary definition, a test result which incorrectly indicates that a particular condition or attribute is present. So at that point, we're talking about the description tab. When you look at a vulnerability, the first thing that you need to ask yourself is quite simply, on the description tab, is that description met by my code? If it is, then you go to the recommendations tab. The primary recommendation on that tab, did I follow it? If not, not a false positive. And that's it. That alone is what determines false positive or not. So the scope of static analysis, let's think about that, is the code that you submit. So thinking about it as the code that you submit, you can understand why one of the common examples, which is, oh, you said that this is an untrusted data source, but it's not an untrusted data source. I trust this data source. Well, that's not a false positive because we don't trust any data source. You're asking us to tell you, is your code vulnerable? If you are depending upon something outside of your code to remediate an issue, then your code itself is still vulnerable, and that's what you're asking us to determine. You're not asking us to determine within your environment, is this exploitable? That's not what static analysis is. It's not saying, okay, in the grand scheme of your environment, this can't be exploited. Well, that's kind of irrelevant to static analysis. Static analysis is this code vulnerable? And if you've got something outside of scope that's remediating, then it is vulnerable, is the answer to that. Talking about primary versus secondary recommendations. So this one isn't always super clear on the description tab, and that's something that we've got some feedback in to change. But anyway, you might see on a lot of vulnerabilities something along the lines of the most secure way to handle this is a whitelist. If a whitelist is impractical, then you can use a blacklist. If a whitelist is impractical, is a business decision, right? So you have to weigh what is worth sacrificing security in the name of a feature? We can't make that determination on your behalf. It would be irresponsible of us to try to do so, right? Because that's your business decision. So we're not going to make that type of decision on your behalf. And it'll kind of be up to you if it's an issue where you want to use that secondary recommendation. Another example is a remediation that's not on the recommendations tab at all. Oh, but I found this in the Microsoft documentation. But we cannot vet every possible remediation to every vulnerability. And so if you're going to use something outside of our recommendations, then it's kind of on you to vet it, make sure that that's okay, and then manually suppress those vulnerabilities. Now, talking about best return on investment, that's not going to give you the best return on your investment because it's going to take a lot of manual work for you to suppress those vulnerabilities. The best return on your investment is to simply take the recommendation and apply it and move on to the next one. And that's just a quick discussion about return on investment. Thank you.